Football grabbed headlines, yet still retained the innocence and charming awkwardness of the last dance at a high school sock hop. The game and a few of its fans were about to make an impact on America's consciousness. And for those just beginning to discover the NFL, it was love at first sight, thanks to a colorful collection of cut-ups and crew cuts, players whose low salaries never dampened their high spirits.
We had a lot of fun playing football. We didn't make much money, so consequently, we had to subsidize it by having fun.
The style of the era was typified by goofy gimmicks like the hidden ball play and by the kind of fast-paced spontaneity one might find in the slapstick comedy of TV stars such as Milton Berle and Sid Caesar. Although this was a man's game, there were times when the action appeared to be dictated by a couple of whimsical women, known as Lady Luck and Mother Nature. Fickle fate and fancy footwork lent a playground atmosphere to pro football's playing fields. But these men had earned the right to cavort like schoolboys, for many of them had been forced to grow up in a hurry on distant, dangerous shores.
These men had come back from the service. They'd been in a war. This was a picnic after what they'd been through, and it was a privilege. And we didn't have all the high salaries and agents and unions and things of this sort that you have today. And it was a real competitive, tough proposition. But once you made it, it was a lot of fun.
This lighthearted approach was especially apparent in those who delivered heavy hits, and a man's body became the most explosive weapon on a 100-yard-long battlefield laden with booby traps. Carrying a football meant becoming a human target. These men faced combat without face masks.
You block and you tackle and you hit people with your face first, and that's the way you're taught, and that's the way you do it if you're good. So your face took one tremendous beating. And if you could hold your teeth or not have a broken nose, you had to be a panty waist. You weren't doing the job.
Players lost their teeth, but never their nerve. And every ball carrier's courage was tested by shots that stretched the rules of the game. The two-fisted 50s were enriched by a crazy combination of wild-eyed personality and eye-popping athletic prowess.
So we got a lot of characters in those days. They were characters, but they were great football players.
The portrait gallery of greats established in the 1950s includes some of the most exciting athletes who ever played the game. Of the 133 men enshrined in the Pro Football Hall of Fame, 55 spent all or part of their playing careers in the 1950s. These players cast giant shadows upon the landscape of pro football, and today these shadows loom even larger in the memories and imaginations of those who love the game. The incomparable individual brilliance and unique team chemistry that marked this era have transcended their specific time and place to make the fabulous 50s an unforgettable part of the magic and myth of pro football.
This ESPN Classic presentation is brought to you by Miller Lite. Taste a true Pilsner.
Hey, Michael, John here. I'm hanging out, having a beer. How come you don't come down?
Man, I'm doing the same thing as you. Why don't you come over here? I mean, the Miller Lite is ice cold and so smooth.
Oh, come on, man.
And classy.
While wild plays and great games made the 50s unique, it was the players who really defined the era. Men like Frank Gifford. To New York fans, Gifford remains a symbol of a shining era, a time when the Giants were a diamond stick pin in the vest of professional football. Gifford joined the Giants in 1952, and in the 12 seasons that he played, the team won 5 divisional titles and 1 world championship. He was the son of an oil rigger, and his family moved frequently, sometimes 15 times in a single year, and Frank often slept on mattresses in the back of pickup trucks. In 1948, he earned a football scholarship to the University of Southern California, and while in school, he appeared briefly in 2 motion pictures whose titles sum up his image: Saturday's Hero and The All-American Boy.
In 1951, Hollywood handsome Frank Gifford was a bit player in movies. But as a tailback for the Southern Cal Trojans, he played the leading man and perfectly fit the role of All-American. The next year, this golden boy from the Golden West was gift-wrapped and presented to the New York Giants in the NFL draft. He carried with him an aura of style and glamour that no university offered in its curriculum.
When I arrived at the Giants' number one draft pick, my wife was a centerfold of Argosy magazine at the time. I was the number one draft pick. There was a lot of talk about my working in movies. I guess I was a good-looking guy. There wasn't any real resentment on the part of the players, I don't think, initially.
This handsome hero of girls' dreams and boys' ambitions became the most versatile running back of the 1950s. He could run, throw, and catch, and the option pass became the Giants' most effective weapon, averaging a touchdown every 4 attempts. Gifford began his career as a defensive back and ended it as a receiver. And although he made every move look effortless, no Giant player worked harder than number 16.
Frank was the type that would stay out after practice, work on pass patterns, do some extra running, and I think his ambition to be as good as he could possibly be motivated him as far as getting maximum out of his abilities.
His looks and gentlemanly ways were mistaken by some as softness. But Gifford was an intense competitor who hated to lose and usually managed to find a way to win.
Frank was a thinking football player that always aware of what defenses they were in and always able to come up with something. He'd come into the huddle and tell you something. I like that. When Sunday came, he made the big catch. He made a big play. He might not catch but 2 balls a game, but one of them was one that he shouldn't have caught, and he did catch it.
By the mid-50s, the Giants were the kings of pro football, and the prince of the city was Frank Gifford.
A handsome man. I mean, here we are, the big old guys down in the mud. You know, we always looked muddy, we always looked grimy, we always looked sweaty. And Frank always looked so good. I mean, I don't remember Frank ever having a muddy uniform. Frank was everything that you ever thought about being. I mean, he was it.
He didn't really associate with too many of the other players. Not because he didn't want to, but because everybody was sort of saying, hey, you know, this guy's really something. And look all he's got going for him. I mean, he had a radio show. Nobody had a radio show.
I'm Frank Gifford. I've been in the league for 10 years. When you're with the Giants, you learn that football is a game of percentages.
So I think most of the players were just sort of saying, boy, what a guy he is.
And then you win ball games.
I worked hard, I think probably more than anyone I know on the Giants. And there was a lot of resentment against me within our own ball club. As we started to do well and we won the championship in 56, I would get all the publicity. I think I handled it rather well. I just never could figure out some of the animosity that I got from players. Once I got over the hurt, really, of that, I just said to hell with it. I went out and I played my game. There were a lot of deliberate shots taken at me. Give me a knee, an elbow, God knows, a finger in the eye. If I'm working against somebody who's emotionally involved with something else, and part of that is, well, I'm going to put that no-good yo-yo freak from California out of the game, I'm going to beat that guy 9 times out of 10.
He aspired to great deeds and possessed the confidence that he could accomplish them. For 8 seasons, he ignored the cheap talk and escaped the cheap shots. But in 1960, he was hospitalized after a clean hit by Concrete Charlie Bednarik.
Bednarik's hit on Frank was the greatest tackle I've ever seen. I mean, you know, I used to stay up at night thinking about hitting a guy like that. Frank was not looking at Bednarik. He should have been looking for him because Charlie could hit, and something's got to give, and it was Frank.
As I caught the ball and turned into him, he hit me in the chest, and I went over backwards. And this is from people telling me about it and looking at the films, because I don't think I remembered much of anything.
We thought he was dead. When I walked by him on the field, he was quivering, and his eyes were back in his head, and I said that, he's gone.
Like a cheap shot, well, it really wasn't. I mean, Bednarik, had he given me a cheap shot, I probably wouldn't be sitting here. He was just a good, solid football player, and a great football player.
Injured in 1961, Gifford came back to help lead the Giants to 2 Eastern Conference titles. When he retired in 1964, he owned the hearts of the fans and had won the respect of his teammates.
Do you like him or do you respect him? I think there's a very fine line between dislike and respect. I think Frank had everybody's respect, and sometimes we confuse that issue. He still has everybody's respect.
I love playing tennis, but being a mom is even better. When I took the Hooked on Phonics reading challenge with my sons, I got to watch them win. Hooked on Phonics is a
show, an exclusive look inside the ring with a champ, Sugar Ray Leonard.
Sugar Ray Leonard.
Sugar Ray's Hit Parade. He'll take you through historic battles and give you the inside story behind every hook, jab, and knockout from fights that are totally
uncut.
Sugar Ray's Hit Parade, coming up next, only on ESPN Classic.
So close to the action, you gotta duck.
Are you old school?
Carved his clean cut. Frank Gifford carved his clean cut image in an era also known for its tough guys. Men who played the game because they loved combat and contact. During the 50s, every team had a notorious hitman. In San Francisco, the 49ers had a smallish linebacker named Hardy Brown, who might have been the most destructive hitter of all time. 49er players measured an opponent's toughness by how he got up, if he got up, after being hit by Hardy Brown.
30 years ago, the San Francisco 49ers fielded a team with 4 future Hall of Famers, but Hardy Brown was not one of them. Number 33 was a skinny linebacker who captained the San Francisco defense in the mid-50s and whose career is nearly forgotten today. But time cannot dull the memory of how Hardy Brown could hit.
Captain Charlie Connolly fires one to Bill Stribling. All goes well until hard-hitting Hardy Brown hurls his hefty husk into the ball carrier, and it's a fumble with Rex Berry recovering for the 49ers.
Brown never used his arms while tackling. Only a well-timed shoulder to separate men from the ball and their senses.
He had an educated shoulder where he'd snap it up and be able to time it so he hit a ball carrier or whatever right underneath his choppers.
I have seen him put people out cold with that shoulder, and Hardy was not a big man. He was only about 195, 200 pounds, but boy, he learned how to put that hump into you from Tulsa, and he hit.
When Bob Waterfield got through playing for the Rams, one day he was crossing some street down there in L.A., and a Volkswagen hit him, and he got up, and they said, "You all right?" And he said, "Yeah, I'm all right, but I thought Hardy Brown was in town." And that's it.
Perhaps Hardy Brown's violent nature was shaped at the Masonic Home for Orphans in Fort Worth, Texas, where he was sent at the tender age of 5 to learn about life and football.
And my father was murdered, and they sent me and my brother and my sister out there, and we started, that's when we started fooling around football. I had an older brother, and he started teaching all the guys to play football out there using that kind of a shoulder. And all those kids that played out the home there, they had to play that way or they wouldn't make the team. One year, we got to the semifinals, and we went to play Amarillo, Texas. And finally, they beat us 14-7. And they came in our dressing room and said, "You guys sure block funny." We said, "Why?" They showed us their lips, and they said, "All of us are split lips."
Football took Hardy Brown out of the orphanage and sent him to Tulsa University, then on to the 49ers, where he developed the skills of a solid pro linebacker. But it was Hardy's unique method of mayhem that made him a folk hero among those he played with and against.
I've seen Hardy Brown knock the helmet right off a player, hit him in the chest, chin, boom. The player's feet would continue down. You would see him running like this, player up in the air, helmet off, and just spread eagle.
Every time we'd play the Chicago Bears, Hallis would have the officials come in and inspect Hardy. Always thought he had a steel plate or something up on his shoulder pad. Hardy was a linebacker and probably a very most punishing linebacker I think that I've ever known, who could throw a punch with exact timing and hit a guy right on the point of the nose. And that's usually where Hardy aimed for, the point of the nose.
It was kind of like a Jack Dempsey punch. It didn't need but 6 inches. That's all it needed, and you went to sleep.
You see these Westerns, you see guys have niches on their belts for guys that killed. Boy, Hardy Brown had niches on his belt for all the jock straps he got. He put more people to sleep with a shoulder lick than anybody I've ever seen.
Take one step forward, keep your back straight, keep your eyes open, and shoot. Over the years, I guess I've got 75 or 80 knockouts playing professional football. No, I don't feel sorry for anybody I hit. I really don't. So they want to get me, too. The Rams had a $500 deal for my getting knocked out of the game, and I found out about it. And the guy that told me was a guy that was in the backfield with me at Tulsa, Paul Berry. And I said, "Paul, if you get to play, come in and hit me and I'll fake and go out and we'll split that $500, $250 apiece."
Hardy, it's been almost 30 years since you've played, and the game's changed a lot since then. What do you think of the NFL today?
I think it's a sissy game. They won't let a linebacker meet a guy coming across the line or anything. And you know what I'd do? If I was playing for some team and one of the good ends came across, well, I'd take a whack at him and knock him out so that we wouldn't have to fool with him anymore. I might have caved a few teeth in.
During the whole time that you played, Hardy, did you ever come across anybody you felt was as tough as you were? Somebody you know who could hit as hard as you could?
Nobody. Nobody. I mean that. Unless it's been one of my teammates at the home.
It's a fact. All whitening toothpastes are not the same. Aquafresh whitening is...
This is ESPN Classic.
Hardy Brown was one of the most feared hitmen in a decade that also featured dauntless daredevils, breathtaking aerial acts, and also clown princes. And one team that provided plenty of laughter and thrills was the Chicago Cardinals. Before moving to St. Louis in 1960, the Cardinals played in Chicago's Comiskey Park. And during the 10-year period between 1950 and 1959, the Cardinals finished in the conference cellar 5 times, and only once did they manage to compile a winning record. But despite their losing ways, they were never dull. and were one of the most entertaining sideshows in the crazy circus that was pro football in the 1950s.
Well, they had some wild coaches, they had some wild players in those days. They had guys who were kind of inept, and the best thing they could do is run as far as away from the defending lineman and throw the ball. And sometimes it took on a kind of a Charlie Chaplin-esque appearance out there.
In true slapstick fashion, the Chicago Cardinals of the 1950s walked a path laden with banana peels. Footballs were thrown like pies, and there were chases worthy of the Keystone Cops. Slapstick movie characters, the Cardinals thrived on ridiculous situations that enabled them to display uncommon resourcefulness. From chaos, the Cardinals created high comedy, and it was high comedy created in a low-budget environment.
We didn't have very good equipment. The Cardinals at that time, the word class never came close to us. We rode the train to games, train to Cleveland, train to Green Bay, wherever we went. It was just it was not the big leagues.
We played at Comiskey Park in those days, which was the home of the White Sox, so they used to sod the infield. And we had scored a touchdown, so it was on the south end of the field, which was the sodded portion. And Billy Cross went in to hold for Joe Gary. Well, the ball was snapped. Joe goes through the motion, makes a kick, and ref throws his hand up in the air. The stands all yell, and what had happened is that Joe had actually kicked a piece of sod had gone over the goalpost. And Billy Cross, I'll never forget, I happened to be looking at Billy, and the look on his face, because there he is still holding the ball.
The team was usually left holding the bag during a decade in which they totaled a mere 33 wins. They boasted but one true superstar, halfback Ollie Matson, whose speed made him seem less a man than a force of nature.
I can remember hearing him go by. It was like the windstorm going by. And I never heard anything like that before. He was just so fast that he created a breeze when he went by.
Matson, number 33, was a rushing, receiving, and return threat, whose many talents would earn him a place in the Hall of Fame. The Cards got a lot out of Matson, and when they eventually traded him, they got a lot for him, or so it seemed.
The Cardinals traded Ollie Matson to the Los Angeles Rams for 11 ballplayers. Of the 11, 9 had to be classified as garbage. Absolute garbage. I think 6 or 7 of them never showed up because they were real dogs.
The Matson trade was one of several unusual personnel decisions.
We drafted a quarterback from Ohio State 1 year, number one. And we said, oh, super, boy, we needed a quarterback badly. And I, being a receiver, thought, I wish we'd get somebody to get the ball to me. And lo and behold, a fellow showed up and started throwing a ball, and he couldn't get the ball 15 yards down the field. And we found out the reason they drafted him, because they liked his picture in the street in Smith. He had nice legs and looked well-proportioned and looked like a real football player.
But even if the team's quarterbacks weren't picture perfect, they did fit into an offense that somehow managed to move the ball forward without benefit of the forward pass. During the 1950s, sleight of hand was the Cardinals' trademark, and the tricks of their trade induced gasps of astonishment from an awestruck audience.
Although we didn't win many games, we were exciting to watch because really sometimes the players didn't know what was going to happen.
A lot of those plays really were not designed plays, needless to say. By looking at them, you could tell they weren't designed plays. I can remember the five head coaches that I played for in 5 years. And sometimes they just throw up their hands in disgust because of the way that some of those zany plays would turn out.
One head coach who devised creative methods of indicating his disgust was Joe Stidahar.
He had a very unique way of paying us. He'd bring in a fistful of brown envelopes, which contained our paychecks. And he would have seen the game films, and he would write a little note on each player about his performance in the previous game, such things as, "I always thought you had no guts, and now after watching the film, it's confirmed." And I remember once we had to play the Bears the last game of the season. And he came storming in the door of the dressing room, threw the checks across the dressing room. They scattered all over the floor. He told us to fight for our own checks. And he says, "If you guys don't beat the Bears next week, I'm not paying any of you. I'm finding you a game salary." Well, that's the only game we won that year. We beat the Bears at Wrigley Field 24-10.
For a while, the Cardinals always seemed to cash in against the Bears. From 1950 to 1955, the Cards won 6 out of 9 meetings from their more successful neighbors from the north side. This crosstown rivalry gave the Cardinals an opportunity to steal the thunder from the team that reigned supreme in the Windy City.
The media, we felt, was always tainted towards the north side, the Chicago Bears. We never had that. And on the south side, I can remember playing games in Comiskey Park in the 50s where there were 9,000 people in the stands. Wrigley Field was always sold out.
But when the Bears went down to play the Cardinals in Comiskey Park, the place was packed. I mean, it was, and it turned into a riot every time. All the games I played against the Cardinals when I was with the Bears ended up in a fight.
But while the Cardinals often won the battles, the Bears ultimately won the war for territorial rights to the toddling town. In 1960, the Cardinals moved to St. Louis, signaling the end of a colorful era. During the 1950s, the Chicago Cardinals didn't produce many victories, but their offbeat and exciting style of play produced plenty of thrills and made them one of the most entertaining teams in NFL history. This ESPN Classic presentation is brought to you by Miller Lite. Taste a true Pilsner.
This is ESPN Classic.
Rick Caceres was one of football's toughest characters. He looked like he could have been one of Al Capone's hired guns. Instead, the Bears star runner of the 50s chose the Chicago backdrop to perform a different kind of mayhem.
Fullback Rick Caceres, number 35, was a hard-edged kid out of Paterson, New Jersey, who brought his street smarts with him to the Chicago Bears. From 1955 through 1966, Caceres slashed through the back alleys of NFL defenses for over 5,600 yards and became pro football's toughest guy on the block.
Rick Caceres was one of the most inspirational guys I ever played with. When you lined up in the huddle and you looked at Rick, you knew he was all business, and I really mean that. I saw the guy try to play a game with a broken ankle, and it was broken. He had shots, he put a high-top shoe on, he had tape under, he had tape over. He went out and tried to play on it.
It was exciting to get into a huddle with him and look at his eyes, because you knew that Rick Caceres was all man and all football. The only thing he wanted to do was play the best he could. He was a man's man to me. I mean, I idolized him because he was a tough guy that didn't wear it outside. He did everything by example. He did nothing by word.
At age 14, Caceres fought on a phony birth certificate and won the New Jersey Middleweight Amateur Championship. Word spread quickly that this was not a man to be trifled with.
Rick was a very nice guy. He was a nice-looking guy and a quiet-spoken guy. But nobody ever messed with Rick Caceres. He had a reputation. I guess he did some boxing, Golden Glove boxing, and I just know nobody ever messed with him. I think that maybe one guy that even Doug Atkins wouldn't have messed around with. Rick just, he was so nice that I just think, you know, you thought of him as being the true silencer, because if he had to hit you, he would have silenced you.
If any one man could be said to have left his imprint on the 1950s, it was Coach Paul Brown. And if any one team could be said to have dominated the decade, it was the one that carried his name, the Cleveland Browns. Paul Brown invented the playbook, the face mask, the draw play, and it was his idea to put coaches in the press box with phones so they could talk to the coaches on the sideline. Brown was the Lindbergh, the Einstein, and the Marconi of pro football. And his team was a perfect expression of his vision of how the game should be played.
The NFL and television formed a perfect marriage during the fabulous 50s, and the best men played for the Cleveland Browns.
To personally account for his and Cleveland's fourth touchdown.
The Browns' incomparable sense of teamwork enabled them to attain a level of perfection that produced three world championships during the decade. Browns were a family operation, and the patriarch was head coach Paul Brown, a man who combined the values of Father Knows Best with the vigilance of Sergeant Friday when it came to devising and enforcing rules of behavior for his players.
In my opening lecture, I always said to them that if you're a bum, a boozer, a chaser, that kind of person, I'm not interested in you making our team.
He gave you the IQ test, and if you flunked the IQ test, you got cut. If you ate too much ice cream, you got cut.
Take out the papers and the trash, or you don't get no spending cash. If you don't scrub that kitchen floor, you ain't gonna rock and roll no more. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Don't hold back.
One of the other things I told him in my opening talk, I don't want to hear you swearing.
How you dress, how you talked, how you ate. He always said, don't slurp your soup.
He believed in what they call the Tuesday rule. After Tuesday, don't touch your wife, you know, keep away from sex.
Don't you give me no dirty looks. Your father's hip, he knows what cooks. Just tell your hoodlum friend outside. You ain't got time to take a ride.
Don't hold back.
I want them to look like an intercollegiate bunch that played for the sheer pleasure of beating somebody.
The Browns' collegiate spirit, fused with thorough professionalism, resulted in 7 conference titles and more victories than any team of the 50s. Cleveland's consistent standard of excellence would have induced fits of ecstasy in most head coaches, but the fussy, feisty Brown was a difficult man to please.
They say, quiet, say, we'll go over what we did wrong in the game. And he'd take out this paper and it would drop all the way to the floor. Said, gee, we just beat these guys 38-0, you know.
As a motivator, Brown brought out the best in his players by telling them that their best wasn't good enough.
He liked to needle you. He had the little idiosyncrasy of saying, you know, and he was always up under you, and he'd look right up in your face and he said, you know what? You're killing our football team.
He would always say little things like, maybe you're not good enough, Bobby Mitchell.
Now you're looking at him, you want to kill him. You want to do it. The next time you go out there, the first jersey you saw opposite of yours, you hit it.
By stirring passions instead of stroking egos, Brown unleashed the ferocious power of great runners such as Motley, number 76, and Jim Brown, number 32. Paul Brown's frosty demeanor crystallized into legend, but there was another story behind his icy reserve.
Of course, the New York writers, I became the cold, deadly, brutal, calculating Brown.
I was sent to Korea, and the whole time I was over there, him and his wife Katie would call my wife every week, ask her if she needed anything, and checking on the kids and to see what was everything was fine with them. He tried to hold back his emotions. He didn't really want to show that he was the human being that he really was.
I really don't feel cold. I guess I might give that impression at times. My former players that I see a lot of them often, and I don't think they feel that way because I have great feeling for them.
The fabulous 50s became pro football's golden era because of teams like the Cleveland Browns
and men such as Paul Brown.
Ever since Mobil One came along, other oil companies have tried to...
King of Daredevils, Evel Knievel. Classic Wide World of Sports, Friday at 8, only on ESPN Classic.
This is ESPN Classic.
Many times, personal records and statistics do not provide an accurate measure of a player. This is certainly true in the case of Willie Gallimore, a running back for the Chicago Bears, who never gained 1,000 yards in any of his 6 pro seasons. As a matter of fact, if it wasn't for a jockey at Miami's Hialeah racetrack, Willie would never have played pro football at all. When George Halas paid a visit to the track, a jockey came up to him and said, "Hey, coach, there's this great little running back down here at Florida A&M, and you ought to give him a look." Well, Halas scouted him, signed him, and Willie the Wisp went on to become one of the most exciting and elusive ball carriers of all time.
In 1957, George Halas took a tip from a jockey at Hialeah Racetrack in Miami and placed a bet not on a horse, but on a player named Willie Gallimore. Gallimore, number 28, came to the Bears as a late-round draft choice from tiny Florida A&M and proved to be one of the last great steals before scouting became sophisticated. Elusive and swift, Willie was the Ferrari of running backs, possessing a passing gear other players only dream about. A rival defensive lineman once said, "He was not hard to bring down once you got your hands on him, but getting your hands on Willie was unbelievably difficult."
Willie was nicknamed Willie the Wisp, and in reality, that was the way he ran. All of a sudden, you'd see him break out into the open, and you don't know where he came from. Willie was unbelievably quick going downfield. He wasn't sideways or this way. He just zoomed down the field and seemed to be so fast nobody could catch him.
You ever try go hunting and a rabbit's in an open field and you try to shoot a rabbit, or you ever try tackling a guy like that? He had speed like you. He, one motion, the same speed, be able to cut. The only difference between him and McElhinney, Willie was faster. To me, it seemed like he did the 109-2 going like this. Fantastic.
Willie the Wisp, Willie Gallimore, puts the Bears on their way to another score. Willie Gallimore reverses his field, bobbles the ball, gets it back, shakes off tackler after tackler on a spectacular touchdown gallop.
Willie Gallimore could turn the corner faster than most fellas could run forward. I've seen him do that.
Gallimore never gained 1,000 yards in a season, but statistics were not the measure of this man. He painted pictures in the open field. Each run was a Rembrandt, and as a collection, they became a gallery that hung in the memory.
It seemed like everybody forgot it, and he's made some runs that I've never seen a back do yet. I have never seen anyone, and I don't believe you have in any of your film, seen anyone catch him from behind or from an angle. He was only 9'6" speed, but he seemed like he run as fast as he had to.
Gallimore was as gifted a pass catcher as he was a runner. And in today's game, he probably would have been turned into a wide receiver.
He could get downfield so fast on the defensive halfback, the safety, the free safety, that the free safety was not free anymore. This was the greatness of true great halfbacks in professional football have to affect. We were playing a game in 1963, I guess it was, and the game was very close, and I hit Willie with a pass about in the middle of the field, man, and he just caught the ball and zoomed through everybody. I mean, it was just like, it was unbelievable. I mean, he was so quick.
He had 2 knee operations the year before the 63 season. I think he broke something like 6 tackles. You know, just having a knee operation is bad enough, but he had 2 of them 1 year. I mean, he was an amazing runner. I always thought he was one of the best runners, and I never could understand why he didn't get more recognition as a runner.
Willie Gallimore, Willie the Wisp. Gone but not forgotten.
If you love the sight of a big white-tailed buck moving through the brush, the excitement of ducks.
Sugar Ray's Hit Parade, coming up next, only on ESPN Classic.
So close to the action, you got a duck.
Are you old school?
The running style of Willie Gallimore is one reason why it's easy to see the 50s as a decade characterized primarily by brilliant individual performers. But pro football has always been a team sport, and the building of a winner has always stemmed from that rare ability to integrate and unite men with diverse personalities and backgrounds. Now, the 1958 Baltimore Colts were perhaps the most colorful and unique collection of individuals ever to win an NFL championship. And the core of this team was the defensive line, a crazy quilt quartet who joined together to help propel the once ragtag Colts to the world championship.
In the late 1950s, the Baltimore Colts won back-to-back world championships. While the glamour of winning went to the big-name stars of the offense, the true personality of the Colts was shaped by the defense, and in particular, by four extraordinary men who played in the defensive line. At right tackle was 6 foot, 6 inch, 290-pound Eugene Lipscomb, the big daddy of the Baltimore Colts. In the 1950s, the main job of the defensive tackle was to jam up the middle. But Big Daddy revolutionized his position when he invented what is now called pursuit. Whenever the play was directed away from him, which was often, Big Daddy pulled out of the line in pursuit of the ball carrier and made more tackles than any lineman on the team.
Big Daddy was big. He was the first big black man in the National Football League. He came here in 56 with me. But his greatest asset was his fact that he could read the defense and then pursue the ball carrier and usually get to him before the ball carrier turned a corner. Gene's forte was his great lateral movement.
When asked to explain his revolutionary technique, Big Daddy said simply, "I take the shortest route to the ball carrier and arrive in ill humor."
He would try to intimidate you. He would try to pull the nose thing, you know, and squeeze your nose. You know, not in a dirty vein, kind of like like he was playing with you, like a cat would play with a mouse. Reach under your face mask and, you know, squeeze your nose and say, "I'm going to get you next time." Would really make you mad as hell.
While Big Daddy was cast as the team bully, number 70, Art Donovan, played the team buffoon.
Maybe he looked like a big marshmallow or a Santa Claus in a football uniform for the player across the line of scrimmage, but a lot of them playing Arthur Donovan got religion. He was especially adept at splitting the double team. He could take double team blocking and separate it like you would 10 pins because of this immense strength that he had in his shoulders.
Donovan was a four-time All-Pro defensive tackle, and he was destined to be the first Baltimore Colt to enter the Hall of Fame.
Belying the fact that he was stout and portly, and didn't look like he had much speed, had all the quickness that you would want for 4 or 5 yards. Exerted tremendous pressure on the quarterback, handled the running plays straight at him with the same kind of adeptness. Just a total football player, all you would want in the defensive lineman.
At right end was Don Joyce, a ferocious pass rusher and a huge man with a huge appetite that was well publicized and well documented.
Joyce's about 6'3", about 270 pounds. And they talk about, you know, insanity is a very, very thin line. Well, I think Joyce, some of the time, watch him in the movies, was on the left side of the line. So I said, "Well, I think Joyce can eat more chicken than anybody else on the team." And the guy said, "No, he can't. For $100, Marchetti can." So they said, "All right." So then he had two more guys bet. So we had $300 bet, and we had this chicken eating contest up in Western Maryland College. So the eight of us, the six guys betting and the two guys eating, the participants, we get in there, and here comes the waiters out with a typical Southern Maryland Sunday afternoon meal. Chicken, mashed potatoes, and peas, and all the trimmings. So anyhow, Gino, he just starts eating the chicken. Well, Joyce, he's eating the chicken, the mashed potatoes, and the peas. And we said, for Christ's sakes, don't worry about the mashed potatoes and peas. Just eat the chicken. So anyhow, Gino eats 23 pieces of chicken. He stops. 23 or 25. Well, Joyce is 24. He said, two more, champ, and we win. We called him champ because in the offseason he was a wrestler. He and Big Daddy had a tag team match. You know, they were tag teams. So anyhow, he says, Al, I'm still hungry. And he eats 36 pieces of chicken. So finally, he says, whoa, he says, I can't eat anymore. He says, I got to wash this down. And in front of him, we had a big pitcher of iced tea. So there you are, champ. Eat it all. He drink it all. We don't care if he blows up now because we won the bet. With that, he reached into his pocket and pulled out four pieces of saccharin and dropped it in the iced tea. He was watching his calories.
Left end Gino Marchetti, number 89, liked quarterbacks more than chicken. And on Sunday afternoons, he dined in style. Gino the Giant was a defensive end in the classic sense. He didn't just play the position, he was the position. You couldn't run at him, by him, or around him. And if you ran away from him, he had the speed to track you down. Marchetti, in his own words, played mad all the time. And his temper was a permanent part of his weaponry.
Marchetti was the backbone of that defense. You know, to watch him pace that locker room before a game, I mean, he was like a caged lion. And I didn't really stop thinking about that till right at this moment you talk about that, but I've been around a lot of locker rooms since then. I don't see, you know, that all the time. I mean, that intensity is not something you just find every day. It's one of the reasons why he was a great one.
Gino Marchetti was the backbone of a defense that had many heroes and more than its share of clowns, who together shared many moments of low comedy and high drama.
We enjoyed the game. Whoever thought that of all the kids that played football down through the years in all the grammar schools and high schools and colleges, that you would be picked or be lucky enough to play professional football? And we used to look back on that and say, we're lucky we're here. This is something great happening to us that it doesn't happen to too many guys. Period. That's the way we all looked at it.
Left hook seemed to have rocked Zarate. Well, what are the...